Sofer is Danielle Sofer, and she is a PhD candidate at the University of Music and Performing Arts in Graz, Austria, where she is writing the dissertation, Making Sex Sound, Erotic Currents in Electronic Music. Danielle holds master's degrees in piano performance from Binghamton University and in music history and theory from Stony Brook University. Her publications span from Central European music from the 1920s to links between electronic music and sexuality. A forthcoming article questions the presumed modernist allegiance to structural listening, and a book co-edited with Krista Rustu on the life and work of British composer Elizabeth McConkie is forthcoming from Universal Edition. Her paper today, Identity and Orientation in Barry Truax's Song of Songs, emerges in response to the dissertation's motivating question, what or who makes electronic music erotic? Please welcome Danielle.
Has described phenomenology as an attitude toward mundane experience, an attitude that seeks to explain one's experience by calling into question what most take for granted as common sense. By this definition, it would seem that electroacoustic music could serve as an ideal field for phenomenological investigation. At least, this was composer Pierre Schaeffer's idea by the end of the 1940s. Although we perceive, understand, and mediate electroacoustic sounds by way of our previous experiences, and while we may even identify some of the sources of the recorded material here, when captured and presented only in sound, electroacoustic music leaves interpretation open. Absent a visibly corresponding body, electroacoustic music distances the senses and sets them apart, though they're never altogether included. The tension between mundane and imaginary presents some obstacles for electroacoustic listeners. One aim of much electroacoustic music is not to represent the real world, but to present an aesthetic semblance of reality, mediated through the composer's organization of musical material and shaped by the technology one uses both to collect this material and to play it back. New sounds are generally produced for each piece, and recorded sounds, even when minimally processed, usually undergo a transformation of their sonic identity, thus ensuring that the sounds can only be produced by electronic means. What listeners hear in electroacoustic music therefore conflicts in many ways with what makes sense in the extrinsic, everyday world, and may be, for all intents, an auditory illusion. It's this idea that I'll be taking as a launching point for my discussion of identity and orientation in electroacoustic music. Using the example of Barry Truax's work, Song of Songs, a four-movement work for oboe d'amore, English horn, and two digital soundtracks, I explore gender as a generalizable concept whose definition is construed by way of identity and orientation. Although biological sex is determined primarily by physiology, this physical factor isn't immediately apparent in electroacoustic music. And yet, it remains clear that electro-vocal music somehow clings to gender, whether we attend to it as meaningful for a given analytical orientation or not. I take for granted that the recorded voice is always situated in relation to a human body, and for this reason, I propose electroacoustic music as a genre that could challenge some societal presumptions of how we perceive and intuit gender and sound. The sounds of the two digital soundtracks of Song of Songs, the voices of two speakers, a singing monk, and environmental sounds from birds, bells, crickets, cicadas, flowing water, and a burning fire, are all subjected in varying degrees to a technique known as time stretching. In this analysis, I focus on the identity and orientation of the two speakers, as we might determine from the sounds of their voices. Just first off, to get a sense of this music, let's listen to the opening minute. Thank you.
Return.
The voices of the speakers, one male and one female, are at times processed to such an extent that they sound either ambiguously gendered, as if spoken through a vocoder, or in more extreme cases, the voices are stretched and filtered so far out of proportion that they're hardly recognizable as voices. If I recognize the voice at all, that's the situation, it is likely that I will attempt to understand, categorize, and parse it, whether I do this consciously or unconsciously. Though given digital processing, I might never successfully identify a sound's source or cause. The voice presents ambiguity, particularly in the slippery categories of identity and orientation. As Judith Butler says, gender identity is a compelling illusion, an object of belief. And in the case of electroacoustic music, the voice is at the heart of this illusion. Gender not only shapes the manner in which we intuit bodies individually, but according to Yves-Kosofsky Sedgwick, gender is also the primary means by which we explore relations between and among bodies. While it's by no means the only consideration in a definition of one's sexual orientation, Sedgwick argues that gender remains the most dominant dimension by which sexual orientation is determined in our contemporary Western society. It is for this reason that I focus on gender identity in my exploration of sexual orientation in Truax's Song of Songs. While the source of a sound may never fully reveal itself, a sound nevertheless retains some trace of its source. To quote from Stephen Connor, dissociated voices always seem to summon in their wake a phantasm of some originating body, effect, convening cause. In claiming that the voice does not fully reveal its source, some recent theorists, such as Brian Payne in his reading of Van Dolar, potentially uphold the long-standing resistance to admitting socially and culturally influencing factors such as gender into music analytical investigations. On the other hand, to say that the voice is never disembodied requires gender and sexual markers to serve as structuring determinants, even when no body is visible. This insistence on the phantasm of some originating body, to recall Connor's description, risks barring potential freedoms offered by the electroacoustic realm. By insisting on prescribed gender categories, such theories threaten to preclude voices from possibly sliding from one gender to another, or anywhere in between, a fluidity of identity that is commonly encountered electroacoustically, but perhaps not easily attained by actual ones. One question I seek to answer in the context of Truax's Song of Songs is if indeed listeners are attempting to explain or identify voices when they hear them, to what extent does gender play a role? In this paper, I explore some ways that Barry Truax constitutes gender in his work, drawing themes from Judith Butler and Yves-Kosofsky Sedgwick, and some supporting evidence from psychoacoustics and empirical studies. Though Truax doesn't refer to any supporting literature from the sciences, his compositional intuitions in terms of gender and psychoacoustic identity very much support such. Canadian composer Barry Truax works at the boundary of Western art music and electroacoustic music. When composing, he carefully and conscientiously determines the manner in which these disciplines relate to one another. He's furthermore aware of several social preconditions that seep in and saturate the musical materials he uses, develops, and produces. As a gay-identifying composer, Truax finds himself at the margin of some mainstream social but also musical practices. And in his article, Homoeroticism and Electroacoustic Music, Absence and Personal Voice, the composer writes, quote, "Art is said to mirror society, but if you look in the mirror and see no reflection, then the implicit message is that you don't exist." He therefore makes an effort to present many representative identities in his music, and primarily diverse gender and sexual identities, rarely encountered in Western art music or the electroacoustic music. Many of Truax's works exhibit the composer's acknowledged homoerotic representations, such as these works, that But today I'll focus on Song of Songs as one example that explores a wider spectrum of gender and sexual representations. The digital processing Truax employs causes the samples he uses to undergo transformations, which is a term first applied to electroacoustic music by composer and electroacoustic theorist Dennis Smalley. Transformations, says Smalley, concern changes in the state of sonic identity. A transformation may be regarded as traveling a certain distance from its base, and the type of change may be defined in terms of its direction, whether the source-cause implications are specific, implied, or free. That is, whether or not we recognize where the sounds come from. The idea of transformed identities relates to the common music theoretical practice of segmentation. As Dora Hannan explains, its disjunction in psychoacoustic musical dimensions, such as pitch, attack point, duration, loudness, timbre, and articulation, this serves as a rationale for segmentation. Truax's method of composition deliberately institutes such disjunctions or transformations in the text and music by first evoking erotic associations, and secondly, by confusing the number of perceived speakers to gradually transform a priori assumptions and expectations listeners might make of the speakers' respective gender and sexual identities. On the soundtracks in Song of Songs, two speakers recite the biblical text of the same name. Although the voices are always manipulated with the time-stretching process, in the opening of the piece, as we heard, Truax initially retains the sonic identities of the voices. As I hear it, the voices of the two speakers, the man recited by Norbert Rupsat and the woman recited by Tekla Schindhorst, are from the beginning identifiable with their representative genders. By having both speakers recite the text in its entirety with the gender pronouns of the original text over the course of the piece, the composer grants each speaker the opportunity to lovingly address the opposite gender, the same gender, or when a voice is digitally transformed, also a lover whose gender identity is orally ambiguous. Truax says that the real-time granular synthesis enhances the sexual illusions of the texts, he says. Granular stretching of voice by adding a great deal of oral volume to the sound with the multiple layers of grain streams often seems to create a sensuousness, if not an erotic quality in the vocal sound. A word becomes a prolonged gesture, often with smooth contours and enriched timbre. Its emotional impact is intensified, and the listener has more time to savor its levels of meaning. Eroticism is enticing precisely on account of that which is left unspoken, its implication and its sense. There's much to suggest that more than mere companionship, these songs in fact depict erotic desire. This is the biblical text. As exemplified by the many physically descriptive passages such as, "Thy stature is like to a palm tree, and thy breasts to clusters of grapes," or, "I sat down under his shadow, and his fruit was sweet to my taste." Song of Songs expert Michael V. Fox explains that, although the characters sometimes refer to each other in the third person out of respect, they often also refer directly toward one another, which is uniquely intimate for text from this time. But although many interpretations of the Song of Songs texts seek to find hidden meanings, sometimes in overemphasizing the anatomical symbolism, such readings distort the text's palpable allure. As Fox reminds us, many things happen in love besides sexual intercourse, and we obscure the particularity of these experiences if we reduce them all to veils that conceal sexual intercourse, which are symbols that really represent coitus. Fox's conclusions speak as much for the text as for the veil that separates recorded source from acousmatic sound. While listeners may not necessarily become aroused by Truax's processing, as is perhaps his goal, his music uniquely addresses sexual relations such that at the very least it may arouse listeners with associations to erotic situations. Although only two characters are named in the text, Fox and other scholars have argued that one can read multiple persona in addition to the man and woman. Truax's setting of the text highlights a collection of personae by including a chorus of digital voices, hearing each speaker recite the text in its entirety with the original gender pronouns, and then having them be layered in and so with several voices one upon the other, may cause listeners to question the number of perceived characters they hear in the work, to question their respective genders, and also, given the erotic tone of the text, to question the characters' various orientations toward one another. In my hearing, Truax's setting first establishes binary categories such as the normative male and female genders or the homo and heterosexual orientations, so as to later break away from these tropes as the piece progresses. The composer's measured departure from normative constraints, I believe, functions to sever, blur, and confuse a priori categories, including the orientation each speaker takes toward their speaking partners when reciting the erotic text. This blurring fragments and hence reorients the respective identities listeners might attribute to each voice. In the remaining time, I'll just introduce two representative examples from Song of Songs. In each of these, I highlight Truax's compositional method because I think it's informative for the manner in which he conceives of gender in his works. Even though these categories of gender and sexuality and identity and orientation exist extrinsically. As mentioned, all of the recorded sounds on the two soundtracks, so not including the Obligamore and the English horn, are subjected to time stretching, a process that turns recorded speech into what the composer refers to as song-like pitch complex. At the time Truax composed this piece in 1992, it was presumed that pitch was the greatest determinant of gender perception in the voice. As determined by Wolf et al. From 1990, without a visually corresponding figure, for example, when speaking on the telephone, a speaker is generally recognized as female when she speaks at a fundamental frequency above 160 Hz, or E below middle C. And listeners identified a male speaker when he spoke at a frequency below 150 Hz, or D below middle C. As we'll see, Truax's transformed voices often intersect at the ambiguous range between 150 and 160 Hz, particularly when the text takes on an erotically suggestive tone. More recent studies have shown that pitch does not necessarily determine the perceived gender of the speaker, but it can be informative when the timbre of a given voice is perceived as ambiguous. According to a 2015 study, when given a choice between male and female genders, listeners correctly identified the gender of the speaker even when the fundamental speaking pitch was altered, so long as the spectral envelope remained unaffected by pitch shifting. Using the first study of Wolf et al. As a model, Weston et al. Asked listeners to gauge a speaker's gender in three distinct sources of auditory stimuli. First, listeners were introduced to the unadjusted recordings of the speakers, and then to two examples of pitch-shifted recordings, so pitch-shifted to the ambiguous range of 160 Hz or thereabouts. One using pitch-synchronous overlap, which retains the spectral envelope through timbre, and the other that changes the pitch and distorts the spectral envelope using a scalar factor or asynchronous range responses. This study found that when the spectral envelope remained intact, so in the first instance, listeners could correctly identify the speaker's gender regardless of the pitch level that they spoke at. Similarly to these techniques employed in this study, in Song of Songs, Barry Truax plays with the fundamental pitch and spectral envelope of the two speakers to elicit various sonic effects. And he does so as deliberate commentary on the relationship between the speakers. Truax doesn't employ pitch shifting in this piece. Rather, he uses pitch synchronous granular synthesis, or the first technique that preserves the spectral envelope and the perceived gender, to variously extend the duration without altering the pitch. He does alter the speaking pitch, however, through filters, like phone filters, and harmonization, both of which inherently change the timbre and spectrum. In the second movement of Song of Songs, Afternoon, we see an example of these techniques in practice, of time stretching and of changing speaker identity by modifying the sample's spectral envelope. In addition to time stretching the voice, Truax highlights select harmonics with the voice's ambiguous range within. In this example, Norbert enters first as a recognizable or determinately male voice, reciting the text, "A garden enclosed is my sister, my spouse, spring shut up. Fountain sealed." You can see the text in the handout. Here, the sample is only minimally time-stretched to retain its spectral envelope. At the Ovo d'Amore's entrance, however, the word fountain is repeated, this time by the female speaker, Tecla, which is located in the bass buttons, and subjected to heavy distortion, granulated and harmonized both upwards and downwards at a ratio of 100 to 1. Neither the production score nor the performance score show the resulting harmony that emerges. So I transcribed the strong sounding frequencies. The Ovo d'Amore is notated at concert pitch. As we can see, the time stretch fountain now sounds in the ambiguous register in a range around E flat 3 or 155 hertz. Interestingly, I discovered from close listening that these pitches, which occurred through the harmonic overlapping of Tecla's voice, are the same frequency as Norbert's initial recitation of the word fountain, just before her entrance. So Truax is emphasizing these lower harmonics in her voice. The same techniques that contribute ambiguity to our perception of the speaker's gender identity also contribute to some blurring and overlap among musical categories. For instance, the initial overlap and subsequent transformation of the two voices is an occasion when the prominent speaking voice drops into the background to take on a supporting role. Let us now hear this example and notice how the two-part texture fragments occasionally into a chorus of many more voices. For example, in the second line, when the F sharp and the lower voices met also with the C sharp, an octave and a fifth higher. Each pitch is provided with its frequency in hertz, with blue text, and the added harmonics in the black text. So the Roman numeral indicates the harmonic series, and the Arabic numeral 4 in parentheses is the fundamental or original frequency. In this example, the first note, E flat, is the first harmonic series, is in the first harmonic series, and sounds at the fundamental 4, the original pitch, but also one octave lower at harmonic 2. And I haven't noted the octave lower. Listeners acquainted with granular synthesis and time stretching will recognize the granularity of this accompanying ambient background, and may even recognize the stream's source as a human voice, given some clues, such as the timbre. And this aliasing that's caused by the consonants was when they're stretched out, so the T and the N that I've notated with X's on lines 1 and 3. From experience, just a note, side note, the dominant audible frequencies change slightly depending on the hardware we use for playback, so hopefully it's ambiguous, such that the speaker who refers to their sister and spouse may not betray a certain gender identity. Neither an opposite sex partner nor a same sex partner can be fully ruled out. The next example builds on this technique. After the romantic tryst in the third movement, evening, in this, the fourth movement, night and daybreak, we hear a gender-ambiguous vocoder-type voice that calls, "My beloved spoke and said to me, rise, my love, my fair one, come away." The melody of the Ancient sounds here diatonically, since it draws on the Jewish cantillation melodies introduced in the first movement. And yet the harmony doesn't function wholly in a tonal manner. Just listen to this. She uses vocoders to perform vocal androgyny so as to resist the frequent scrutiny that often inflicts the female body as spectacle. McCleary writes, quote, "Laurie Anderson's music is multiply charged. It is electronically saturated at the same time as it insists on the body." This, she says, contrasts with the neutrality with which music is generally regarded, what she terms music's neuter enterprise. In a similar but opposite tactic, I see Truax denying the visually corresponding bodies of his performance so as to leave room for ambiguity. Like Anderson, I see Truax's work confronting music's presumed neuter presence by simultaneously insisting on the gendered voice while also raising questions as to how categories of gender are typically defined in musical contexts. Truax, like Anderson, breaks away from the mold of the composer typically assigned to his gender. He's a male composer who embraces sexual imagery and not by way of the common misogynist representations all too prevalent in the Western musical canon. Addressing gender in music can be a complicated task. On the one hand, we don't wish to reduce the complex relationships, both musical and erotic, that emerge in Song of Songs by identifying one speaker as female and the other as male. But on the other hand, we might be losing some aspect of the experience by omitting a discussion of gender and its implications for musical listening. What I find compelling about Truax's music are the ways he draws attention to difference, to gender identity and sexual orientation, while simultaneously diminishing the centrality of normative categories, whether the binary man-woman, gay-straight categories, or the typical musical oppositions between melody and harmony, and between timbral profiles and harmonic spectrum. Perhaps we might take Truax as an example for how we could approach the issues of gender and sexuality in musical composition, but we may also wish to acknowledge his compositional approach as an analytical orientation that doesn't delimit identities according to a priori assumption.